thunder and lightning, and we're going to start again. Hopefully, Dr. Sue Savage-Rumbaugh will join us very shortly, and then Julia will join us. So I'm telling Sue Savage-Rumbaugh that I sent her a new invitation. We're going to take it a little bit at a time. Okay, don't know. Okay, so Sue has gotten my invitation. So, come on in. There's thunder and lightning. We're waiting for Sue. Okay, Sue is trying to come in. There's the painting behind me. Unless I were to get up. There you are, Sue.
Yeah, I think it's because I didn't use the Chrome browser.
Oh, yeah, you have to use the Chrome browser. I think we did that last time. So shall I invite Julia now?
Yeah, it said I could use the Safari, but and Chrome had disappeared from my computer, but I put it back and tried it, so.
Let me just try to see if I can invite Julia very quickly. There she is, Julia Hanna. invite. My invitation was posted. I invited you now, I'm saying to Julia. So it's good to have you here, Sue.
Well, it's nice to be here, Aya, finally, at last.
Yeah.
It's easy to blame people on the weather sometimes when you don't know quite what you're doing.
Yeah, it takes a while. And we're having terrible weather over here. I have thunder. I don't know if you can hear it. I had to let my dog Leo inside because it's just so awful outside. So you might hear him making a noise or two as well. And occasionally when we have thunder, Bo will feel the need to vocalize at the thunder. So you might eventually hear that too.
I saw beautiful displays of lightning on the way back here. Just incredible displays in the sky.
Okay, Julia says that she will join.
Okay.
So was there really a tornado, or was that just something they were afraid might happen?
I think there was a tornado just across the border in Arkansas.
Oh, okay.
Well, they showed pictures of cars that had been thrown all around.
Okay, I think I'm here. I see Sue.
Okay, we're all here. Hi, hey. Julia.
Hi.
My phone is not behaving, so there we go. Okay, there we go.
Okay, so Sue, I feel as if I went a little bit too fast the last time, and I didn't ask you about Austin and Sherman. So, and I think that was an important breakthrough in your research. I thought you might want to tell us about that.
Well, Austin and Sherman were two young chimps that we started working with in 1975. They were actually chimps from the Yerkes nursery. Austin was one of the babies born to a group of deprived mothers that had been reared in isolation cribs. And she did not care for him at all from birth. So he had to be separated from birth and raised in the Yerkes nursery. And Sherman was separated, I'm not sure why, at 1.5 years. And they were about 2.5 and 3, or 2 and 2.5 when I got there. They had been trying to teach them symbols for maybe 8 months, and they weren't learning anything at all. And this was a huge contrast, because Lana had very quickly, within 6 months, learned how to make many different stock sentences. And in fact, Lana had learned so much so fast and began to focus on so many novel sentences and pick up words on her own and engage in dialogue that they felt that all of the things they had put in the system to make sure it would work weren't really needed for Sherman and Austin. So when they built the systems for Sherman and Austin, they dropped out a lot of features. For example, they didn't have an experimenter's keyboard and a chimpanzee's keyboard. They didn't have experimenter projectors and chimpanzee projectors. They had one set of projectors for projecting everything. And they also did not have dispensers. So they thought they could start right out with words. And they went in and were holding up objects and trying to get the apes to snuggle. I gotta move something here off my desk so I can. They were trying to get the apes, when they held up an object, to learn a word. So they might hold up a pen and then have the chimp punch the key for pen, or hold up salt and have the chimp punch the symbol for salt. And it wasn't working at all. The experimental protocol was that there were actually 4 young chimps when they began, and not only Sherman and Austin, but Erica and Kenton. And 2 of them were to learn object names first, and 2 were to learn color names first to see which was easiest. And none were learning anything at all. So I requested that the same kinds of electronic technology that had been utilized for Lana be utilized with Austin and Sherman. So the experimenter's keyboard was working. We couldn't put in a second row of projectors, but we had dispensers, and they could look and see what food was in four separate dispensers outside their room, and if they punched a key, the dispenser turned and they got that food. And they learned that within a couple of days. So if they saw apples in one dispenser, they would hit apple. If they saw bananas in another dispenser, they would hit banana. And you could move the keys all around. It didn't make any difference. So there was a huge distinction between sitting there for months and months and holding up an object and trying to get them to make the name of the object, and simply letting something happen that they wanted to happen when they touched a key. So they were still getting bananas and apples and oranges and pieces of chow for naming the objects. But this took that confound out. So they focused attention on banana, they got banana. They focused attention on apple, they got banana. So there was a direct one-to-one relationship between what they did and what happened. So you might think that right away, when they were able to do that within just a few days, that they were learning apple and banana and orange and pear. Well, that wasn't what they were learning. They were learning spatial locations, this dispenser, and this dispenser. So when you see this dispenser, you hit this key, and when you see that dispenser, you hit that key. So that just was the first indication, and there have been many, many, many others in the literature, and there were even many before that, that apes are spatially oriented. They come to map things in space, and of course you would expect this because they spend all of their time moving through the forest and finding things to eat and finding places to go. And if they don't have a map of the forest, it's extremely easy to get lost or dislocated. You can get lost or dislocated within 5 or 10 minutes in the forest. It's so.
But did you change the items in the dispenser so that sometimes a banana was in this dispenser and sometimes it was in that dispenser and so on and so forth?
Yes, and they were able to fairly rapidly learn that now this key operated that dispenser and this key operated that dispenser because their world is spatial. And there had been one of the earliest studies was done in the Yerkes labs in Orange Park, Florida, where they took a very, very young chimpanzee, I think 2 or 3, and they had a circle of 25 paired objects in a big circle, maybe 20 feet in diameter. And they showed the chimpanzee 2 boxes, and he could see that in each pair, 1 box had food and the other didn't. And they showed him all around the circle, and then he was correct every time. And he could even wait days or weeks and go back. And after one glance, this chimp, any chimp really, but they only used 1 or 2, could tell what was in the 2 boxes. So he was learning.
Is there a difference between females and males? Because among humans, we have this idea that males are much better at spatial orientation and spatial tasks than females. Is there a difference among chimpanzees?
I don't know of studies that have particularly looked at spatial skills in males versus females. In the work that Matsuzawa has done, he's able to show as many as 20 or 25 things on a screen at a rate that no human could follow. And I would have to check his papers to see if he's found any difference between the sexes. I can say that I know who is a female, is able to do it with alacrity. So I don't see that. You might realize that as humans begin to bring foods to their campfires and to their villages, that's when our population really first began to increase quite rapidly. And the males, and having males there and having a group there allows the infant a great deal more protection. And when the infant has more protection, the infant can spontaneously vocalize more without fear of a predator. Also, the females are going to be there taking care of the infants while the males are going to be out gathering food and bringing it back, or hunting and bringing something back. The females generally spend more time in the camp. So those differences in lifestyle, as we know now, can place different epigenetic markers on the genome. And those epigenetic markers control sensitivities. They don't actually control in any direct sense, as far as we know in most cases, tightly controlled behavior, but they control sensitivities. And they can last, I think it's been documented, for at least up to 7 generations. So when we talk about a male chimpanzee doing something or a female, or when we talk about a chimpanzee doing something versus a person, we need to think about what that chimpanzee or that person has had relatives that have been doing for the last 10 or 15 or 20 or 100 years or 1,000 years. Because behavior itself is unfolding given the kinds of behavior that previous generations engaged in, but it's not instinct. It's not necessarily hardwired. You come predisposed to learn something that's probably going to be in your environment, to be particularly sensitive, more sensitive to some kinds of things than others, because those aren't in your environment. So let's say you're a chimpanzee and you need to map the environment really, really well and fast, then you may come with a sensitivity to being able to do that when that task is imposed upon you. And if you're a human and you don't need to do that because you don't need to do it at all now because you've got your iPhone and it's going to take you anywhere. So you don't even need to do it as well as you did the last generation. And there are many skills like that. We're dropping out and picking others up. And that well may be encoded in epigenetic markers. So when I talk about chimpanzees being, in general, very good at something, that means 2 or 3 or 4, most have been tested carefully in captivity. That's what it means. A few chimpanzees that have been raised in captivity have been tested fairly carefully in captivity, and they show these abilities. And then you make some kind of general statement about humans. So when I say that Sherman and Austin were very sensitive to the spatial location of the dispensers, I can also add that Alikia, a female, was very sensitive to the spatial location of the dispensers. I can talk about a lot of data in which chimpanzees seem to be better able to do that than we are, but that doesn't mean that it's always going to be that way. It means their lifestyle led to that particular skill being acquired really rapidly, and it didn't lead to us doing that. But if we changed our lifestyle, it might change really very rapidly. I did a study to try to find out how many trees Matata could remember when she first was exposed. I could take her out in a large forest. So I would hide things at the basis of trees. I think I first tried 10 or 15 trees, and they had a marker on them. So if she went to a tree and she saw a marker, it like a triangle or a square or something, it meant there was food at the base of that tree. And then I would continue to hide food under the grass at the base of that tree and see if she would remember it without a marker. And she just went up so rapidly, I couldn't even keep up with her. I mean, she could remember hundreds of individual trees. And I was having trouble myself remembering which trees without marking them. And then if I marked them, then she might look at the marker. So it was a difficult study to run. But in general, given our current lifestyle in modern civilization, at least we humans who have been tested in modern civilization, don't focus on spatial things as connected so directly with symbols as Sherman and Austin did. It seemed that when we were trying to connect it with something that was a marker on a keyboard and that we hoped would become a symbol, what was first and foremost in their attention was the location, even though you would think it would be, oh, it's an M&M, I just got an M&M, it's wonderful. You know, I'm going to remember when I hit this, I get an M&M. That wasn't what they remembered. So finally, what I had to do was to slowly take, say, an M&M out of one dispenser and put it in the dispenser they had just asked for a banana. So they watched me move it into the dispenser they had just used to ask for a banana. And they then began to ask for an M&M, and then I would put a banana back in, or a piece of orange, or a piece of chow. So I would go back and forth between the dispensers that were spatially oriented and had these foods and put them all in one dispenser. But if you think about what a chimpanzee would need to do, let's say it's going to find the orange tree. The orange tree is always going to be where the orange tree grows, and the chow tree is always going to be where the chow tree grows. The food isn't going to move around in the world. But in our world, where we go take food and we bring it back to the camp, then we're moving the food all around. We're moving it out in the forest. It's all moving around when we're cooking it. So we're going to attach labels to this food independent of where it is, because we're bringing it all together. Historically, we're doing that.
Yeah, but there was another linguistic issue, which was that the chimps didn't know that you were looking for nouns or names of objects, and they were thinking that it meant give me something, right? Every time that they were asking for something from a dispenser, and if they named the thing, that then it didn't actually mean that thing under all conditions. It meant give me that thing, right? It was like a complete sentence.
Well, let's just make things as clear as possible for the viewers. Why don't you talk about what the word mean means to you?
Well, what it signifies in the real world, what it signifies as to what you are signaling to another being that you want them to do, or so in other words, it's really not necessarily very natural to pick up a plastic egg and say, this is a plastic egg. And it's certainly not very natural for a chimpanzee who's just trying to get something. I mean, he'll do whatever you require him to do to get the thing, but he's not necessarily having a conversation with you, because it's almost like every sentence or every utterance is an imperative. It's every utterance is a command, if what they're really trying to do is get something out of a dispenser.
Do you think that words, you can find out what words mean by using a dictionary?
Well, not unless you know a lot of other words. No, not at all.
So the word mean is tricky, because it's what I mean when I'm talking to you. And words can mean lots of different things in different circumstances. So the meaning is something that's co-constructed. How the word is used and what we hope will take place in your mind and my mind, or your behavior and my behavior, is what we mean. And we only get some understanding and approximation of what we mean by actually attempting to make meaning to one another. And the
right.
only way we can attempt to make meaning to one another, there's only one way, and that's with dialogue. There's no other way. So when people shut down a dialogue, or when nations shut down a dialogue, there's no way that any kind of meaning can be exchanged. There has to be a dialogue. So when Sherman and Austin began to be able to hit M&M or banana or chow or orange or whichever food I had in the dispenser, the one dispenser that turned, and to hit the one key that meant that and make that dispenser turn, they weren't meaning to me. They weren't talking to me. And whether they were meaning to the computer or the machine, one can speculate on, but I doubt it, because most individuals begin to realize that while you can exchange key presses or vocalizations with a computer in order to get the computer to do something, you're not really meaning to the computer, in the same sense that when you talk to a human being, you are attempting to exchange meaning.
Well, I don't know. I think in all situations, there's another way to look at it, and that is that we want to get something, and that something might not be something physical. It might be a situation, a relationship, affection, whatever it is that we're trying to get. We're trying to see how we can get this other creature that we could actually think of as a computer. Each of us is a mind. Each of us is a mind inside a body. And unless you learn the magic words, you're not going to get what you want from that other person. So I think it actually is true that in some ways, language can be always manipulative, and every person can be seen as a dispenser. It's just that we're very complicated dispensers. What do you think about that, Sue?
I think that lots of language can be used in sort of a request format like that, in which you're hoping to gain something from the other party. And I believe that conditioning principles can explain all of language that is of that form. But I think that language goes way, way, way beyond that. And it allows us to build imaginary worlds, to be creative, to think about things that we wouldn't have even thought about if we hadn't read a book or heard somebody else speak about them. And that one of the main motivations for language is to establish a group of individuals. They can be in your country or your culture or just your clique, but a group of individuals with whom you can share meaning. And that is the ability to share meaning is in many ways deeper and more essential to what we think of as human than just the ability to get something. Humans do engage in trade. They do have a huge fascination with objects, and objects are purchased by money, and a lot of conversation, particularly if you watch things like Game of Thrones. There probably isn't anything in many areas today where you actually see the real heart of language being used. And I think you're probably right, Aya, in lots of occasions. And I think it's sad that is very, in some situations, the most prevalent of all. But I don't think that that's the reason, the raison d'être for language.
Okay.
Back to Sherman and Austin. If they were meaning, they were meaning only to a computer, and the computer really didn't care. It either turned the dispenser or it didn't. It didn't really have a heart.
Okay.
So they had to have a being to mean something to. So obviously that needed to be me or one of the other people working with me. But at that time, the other people working with me weren't really trying to solve this whole language thing. I mean, I could ask them to do things and they would do them, but they weren't really trying to think about what language is, what language does. How are you going to pull this language out of this ape that just came out of the box and it's rocking and it's sucking its thumb and it can't hardly concentrate on the keyboard and it didn't have a mother and, you know, it didn't really have pointing, it didn't have gesturing, it didn't have joint case, it didn't have eye contact, all these pre-verbal things that babies do before they start actually talking, but they're in a dialogue with those. It didn't even have those.
Well, were you allowed to go in with them?
I was with them all day, every day. Okay. I was carrying them, hugging them. Before I was working with them, when they weren't learning anything, those earlier months, they were taken from one room and put in a small room, and somebody sat with them and held the things up. But they didn't have, I don't know what you might call floor time. I'm not sure I would call it that, but they didn't have an engaged relationship, a relationship where the pre-verbal behavior was used in a verbal way to mean things. Like, I want to pick you up. I want to go with you somewhere. I want you to hold on. You know, you can convey all those things easily to a young chimp. And you don't need any symbols to do it. The gestural repertoire that's common between us is sufficient. And I think there's recently an article to say that that's sufficient for what I would call all Homo orangs, gorillas, bonobos, and humans, and chimpanzees. But in any case, one thing I decided to do was, okay, Sherman and Austin know that these foods are in the refrigerator before I get them out and put them in the dispenser. They see me get these foods out and chop them up and put them in bowls, and then I stand there with the poles and I put them in the dispenser, and then they ask the computer. Ask is probably not the right word. They hit a key and the computer bends the item. So I decided that I would position myself kind of over by the refrigerator, kind of behind the door, and I would peek in the refrigerator and I would look out at Sherman and Austin, and I would act like I'm getting something out of the refrigerator. Hey guys, you see me? I'm opening the refrigerator. I'm getting something out. You know, what do you want? What do you want? You know, and they didn't understand the English, but I could, you know, sort of move my hand like this or this. And if they hit M&Ms or banana on the keyboard, kind of even in anticipation that I might put them in the dispenser and let the computer do its job, then I'd say, oh, you want M&Ms, you want M&Ms, this is wonderful, I'll get them out. And I would go with a whole bunch of M&Ms or bean cake or whatever it was and give them that item. So you could say, well, that was a conditioned response to request the item from me. That would be a psychological explanation. Possibly it was, but they also knew that they were communicating with me. They were making a request of me, and I didn't really know what they wanted. They could have wanted any of those foods. And I had to listen and watch them very carefully and get the one that they asked for. So that also clicked in really fast. And I'm starting to lay a pattern here to say, when you're trying to teach an ape something and it's not working, you might do it for months and it's not working. And when you figure out what it is that they're not understanding, then suddenly you can make really rapid progress. So when they weren't understanding after months of training with somebody holding up an object, and then I put it in these four separate spatial locations, and within a few days, they've learned those. You know, all four chimps learn those easily. But they weren't learning the food. And when I figured out what to do with the food, to move it right in front of them from one space to another space while we were following that spatial move, and then when I figured out how to stand there in front of the refrigerator and be completely baffled as to what they wanted, each of those things just clicked in really, really, really rapidly. So you have to have a careful understanding, an analytical, thoughtful, broad-based understanding of what it is that this particular organism, be it a child with retardation, a child with autism, an ape that's been reared in a nursery, or a young kanzi that's picking up everything so fast you don't need to ever do any of these things. you still have to have, with each organism, it's slightly different what it isn't particularly understanding. And all throughout my work with apes, I've found that same pattern. There is something they're not really grasping until I can figure out what that particular thing is and how to solve that one thing that's not clicking in their mind. I'm kind of at a dead end. But once I figure that out, things move very, very rapidly. So in the report, I did say that, yes, they could request things from the dispensers, and they could request things from me, and I use that term request, although it's really very different in both cases. And they probably could have requested me then easily to put things in a bowl and to take things out of a bowl. You know, you can make those kinds of steps. But I didn't really focus on that at that point in time because I was asked to move toward naming. So I just held up the item. I mean, they know these lexigrams cold. You can move them any place on the keyboard. They can use them to request in these two situations. They don't have any trouble discriminating the lexigrams. They don't have any trouble finding the lexigrams. They don't have any trouble knowing which lexigram goes with which food if they want to eat the food. They've got that down. So you just hold up the food. Salt isn't one of them, but let's say you hold up salt. All they have to do is look at the salt and hit the key. Now, they've looked at the salt when it was in the dispenser and hit the key. They've looked at the salt. I mean, they've imagined the salt, my reaching for it in the refrigerator when they couldn't see it, and they had to hit the salt so I would bring it out. So they have salt in their imagination. They have salt in their vision. It's paired with this key. By any learning paradigm or learning theory that psychology had offered at that time, and what it even offers now in most animal behavior work, is that you would hold this up and they would easily learn to hit the key because they have all the components. But the problem is that that isn't communicating with the computer, if you want to call, I think communicating with the computer is not a good term. That isn't activating the computer, and it isn't communicating with Sue. It's just doing something when Sue holds the salt up. It's hitting the same key. That was not intuitive. That was not something that they understood. They made no connection, none. They just kept hitting the wrong keys for a very long period of time. So I stopped for a while, and I decided that I needed more dialogue. I needed more interaction. I would try to hit a key and see if they could look through an array of foods, because those were the only words they had in their vocabulary, and see if they could look through an array of foods and give me a food. Again, they knew the symbols. They knew the foods. They didn't have any problem making a pairing in those two previous situations. So they didn't have to learn anything particularly new. But they had to look through, instead of looking through an array of symbols on a board, they had to look through an array of foods in front of them and then pick one depending on which symbol I hit. Well, I hadn't been hitting many symbols. You know, I was just doing these other things that I've talked about. So, and these were all things that Lana had learned to do really easily with the way language was introduced to her, which is a completely different story, and how the introduction to Lana had moved her almost imperceptibly through these big log jams and problems that I was having is a completely separate story. But anyway, when we got to the naming log jam, and then I tried to look through, ask for foods when there was an array of foods in front of them, what do you think was the biggest problem to start with?
When you ask them for look for food to give to you?
Yeah, assume this is my keyboard.
Well, I'm not sure, but I would think that they would have a reason to want to do that.
What?
They would have to want to do that. They would have to be motivated. They would have to have a reason to want to do this for you.
Well, that was one problem. How would you solve that problem?
Well, I solved that problem through relationships. You know, when I asked Bo to do something for me, he has to actually want to do it, otherwise he doesn't.
Well, I don't think that they initially didn't want to. You see, when you're looking at a food and an array of symbols, the relationship between moving that food through space or getting somebody to do something with that food and the array of symbols is one directional. When you're looking at an array of foods and somebody else is using the symbols, that's a completely different direction. Now, maybe in your case, because Bo was exposed to spelling, and you call them lexigrams?
I did call them lexigrams. Lexigrams were simply the words in ordinary standard orthography. I didn't teach him what the letters were, and he figured out the letters later, much later. You know, so at the time, he just had to memorize what the word looked like in the standard orthography.
Uh-huh. So, Sherman and Austin were raised in the nursery, so they didn't have any of the kind of background that Bo had or Kanzi had. I had to take them as I found them. And I wasn't able to just take them home or keep them with me. Yerkes Center would not have allowed that. So I put all of the foods in an array in front of them. And the first thing, of course, they wanted to do was eat all of the foods.
Sure. Yeah, that's what I would expect.
If you look at the videotapes of Nim, who was raised in a home, when they're putting food in front of him, that's what he wanted to do. He wanted to eat all of the different foods.
Of course.
Well, that's a sort of a cultural thing. When you're a human child and you sit down, maybe in some homes you just take whatever's on the table, and maybe in others you have to wait till it's passed or wait till somebody else has a turn. Or there are all kinds of cultural things. So the first cultural thing I had to teach Sherman and Austin was it wasn't their turn to eat. It was my turn to eat. So I had to teach them turn-taking as regards food. And maybe that's implicit in the culture that you and Bo have. I don't know. But I had to teach this cultural variable that it's my turn to eat. Well, if we're going to take turns eating, I have to want to eat. You know, I might not really be hungry, and I might not want these foods, but I have to eat them. So it makes sense to them that I want to eat them and that we're taking turns. So I couldn't do this too much because I would get too full and eat too many foods that I didn't really want. And I certainly didn't want the bean cake and a lot of the, I really don't want the M&Ms either. You know? So I had to, like, you know, act like I wanted all of these things. And then when they realized that I wanted to eat them, but it was, they could have a turn and then I could have a turn, that they had to pay attention to my touching of a symbol. Now, when you touch symbols on Bo's door, can you be completely quiet and does he pay attention and you can just spell to him?
Well, yes, but Ed, when he spells to me, I can sound it out for him. I can not sound it out and he knows, but most of the time I speak out loud to him and he spells to me.
But if he understands the symbols, the printed letters, and that those printed letters combine into a word and a word has meaning, then yes. If you're using the door to make meaning to him, by touching those symbols and being quiet, which is what he does. I mean, he's quiet. Sherman and Austin were quiet, you know, when they used the keyboard. So I was being quiet when I used the keyboard, because in all of my thinking and work, everything is co-constructed. Dialogue is co-constructed. Behavior is co-constructed. So I'm trying to co-construct a meaningful kind of mini culture about using these few words with each other in meaningful ways, ways that we can anticipate, and headed toward ways where everything just doesn't mean you get something, but headed toward ways where my goal is to realize I have an idea in my mind and I want that idea in your mind. Whatever you do or do not with that idea is not what I'm trying to affect. I'm trying to give you a concept or an idea that's in my mind to your mind. I mean, that was where I wanted to go with Sherman and Austin.
I'm a little bit curious about how you enforce the turn-taking. In other words, if they didn't want to give you your turn, what did you do?
Well, I just kind of put my hands over the food and said, you know, these are mine, and I want this one.
All right.
Nonverbal behavior. Nonverbal is not the right word. Gestures and vocalizations that they could comprehend that were exaggerated and heartfelt and big, you know, emotion. So they began to pay attention to what I wanted and to give me food. And they realized that this language they were learning wasn't all just about what they wanted. It had something to do with all the rest of the world. And then I could replace myself with another person who worked there, and they might want the food and they might use the keyboard as well. So that helped in moving toward naming, but it was still difficult. But I call that a kind of receptive competency. They're paying attention to me. So you can either have a productive competency or a receptive competency. That was the beginning of a receptive competency. And after they could ask for things and they could comprehend or have a receptive competency, then I went back to the naming and continued. And it seemed like it took maybe, I don't know, I've recorded the data, but just a mass of trials. And then at one point, they just suddenly seemed to get it. And they realized that this, just holding it up, I'm supposed to pair a symbol with it. And even though just this holding it up doesn't mean that I want it, it doesn't mean that you want it, it doesn't mean anything other than this meaningless thing that I'm supposed to pair a symbol with it. So this is the most meaningless act of all. And it was the last one in those three major ones that we think of with language. It was the last one that came in. And there wasn't any way that I could get it in by doing anything that had anything to do with communication, because it isn't communicative. It's just a paired associate response is all it is.
It's because it's not a full sentence. I mean, the full sentence would be about an action, about something taking place. And the idea that you would have to necessarily learn the name of a thing separately from a situation, that's not really how language works for any of us.
Well, I understand that in the sense that I was using a lot of nonverbal things, whether it's a receptive competence or a productive competence, we're transferring the food in one way or another from one being to another. But because I wasn't doing all of that in symbols, it wasn't even thought of as a sentence by any of the linguists working on the project at the time. Yeah. And whether I could have had them understand, I want the bean cake that is in the dispenser, I don't know. As you know, that's how Lana started out. Please, machine, give piece of bread. Please, yeah. Machine, give M&M.
Right. And because then you could take that same template, of a sentence, and then just replace one item, and that item would be a different thing that you wanted to be given. Then it's easier to understand later what the item, you know, what kind of meaning, what kind of flavor the item has.
Well, that was Duane's original hypothesis, and that's why he built the template that way. And certainly linguists can think of it that way, but psychologists such as Herb Terrace don't think of the template in the way that a linguist or anybody who's looking at grammar and the different roles in the template would look at it. They look at it as a sequence of behaviors. That's why Herb Terrace decided, aha, I'm going to show that apes don't know anything, and that this whole template idea, when you apply it to an animal, is completely wrong, and that it's all conditioned. But when you apply it to a human, it just works perfectly, because the human has the template right inside the brain. And all I'm doing is tapping onto that template.
Well, do you really think Terrace set out to disprove that chimps can use language? Or is that just something that later happened when he lost his funding?
I can tell you several things. I can tell you that Herb Terrace started with a chimp before Nim. That chimp was named Bruno. And I worked with Bruno at the University of Oklahoma. And he wasn't able to do the things with Bruno that he later tried to do with Nim by raising Nim in a family. I can tell you that from watching the videotapes of Nim, it's not possible. It's absolutely not possible that Herb Terrace did not know Nim was imitating, and that he worked with him for 3 or 4 years, and then he studied these tapes with these graduate students, and lo and behold, after looking at hundreds of hours of tape and getting, he found, oh, Nim is really imitating. Nim spent hours every day, 8 hours, I don't know how many, going to this little room in Cornell University and sitting on the floor with Laura Petito or Tom or somebody, and they would hold up objects, and Nim, and they would say, sign with me, and then they would sign and he would sign. They did it all day, every day. Nim is being taught to imitate. And then Terrace looks at the tapes and says, oh my God, this is all imitation. That must have been what Washoe was doing. Well, that was not what Washoe was doing on a daily basis. She did do some of that, but Nim did it all day, every day. So why would anyone in Herb Terrace's position do that unless they just wanted to take ape language apart? It makes no sense. And I've put a few of those tapes on the web. He gave me 30 hours of them. And if you don't translate the signs for the people that Nim is making and the person is making, you see that the person is exasperated and Nim is rocking and Nim is pulling on his diapers and the people are trying really hard. But as soon as you start putting those signs into words, you see exactly what's happening, that Nim is not being allowed to use language. He's being taught to imitate not only words, but an entire template. And they won't allow him to do anything else other than that. They think that's what he needs to learn. So it's not possible that the person doing it did not know what they're doing. It's not possible that the person taping it did not know what they were taping. And it's not possible that the person looking at it could think that Terrace was trying to see, was trying to actually replicate the Gardner's method. He was not. That's absolutely clear.
But are you saying that everybody who was in on Project Nim was a conspirator, you know, trying not to do it right?
Well, they were behaviorists. The Gardners were behaviorists in a different sense. And Beatrice Gardner came from a background in ethology, so they kind of mixed ethology and behaviorism. But Terrace was the arch behaviorist. He was the best behaviorist, you know, the behaviorist who really knew how to control all the variables and manipulate things just right. And if you really did behaviorism right, then of course you could make an ape look like it had language if you really knew what you were doing. The Gardners were considered by Herb Terrace lower class behaviorists. They didn't really know how to control behavior as well as Herb Terrace did. So these things were happening in their work and they were unaware of it. But he would control them and make them all happen on purpose in his work, and then Nim would add language. Well, and it turned out that the language that Nim had was completely shaped. And it if you watch the tapes, there is not really dialogue between Nim and the trainer. The trainer's doing these things, and Nim is to do what's asked. The most dialogue is like, no, stop that. Stop, stop, stop. Now, stop. You know, do this. Sit down here. And Nim is just kind of like that. You know, if you want to call that dialogue. Now, whatever happened at the house after the 8 hours of training, I don't know, but it was the same people. So I don't think they were really, really talking to Nim. I mean, the Gardeners, you watch their tapes. They're really trying to talk to Washoe. They may not really quite get what she doesn't understand. And they may ask her to do signs over in stupid ways, like tell that she has to tell them every time that she wants the door open. And they stand there and say, what do you want? What do you want? What do you want? You know, that's not necessarily good because the meaning has already been transmitted. She's already pointed to the door and kind of tried to open it. So the meaning is gone between them. The meaning is there. So they're just putting the name on the meaning. That isn't what Herb Terrace was doing. You can watch the tapes. I'm going to put them on the web and make these kinds of comments about them in detail. I think once the comments are made, it's easy to see. I think people out there just haven't known what they're watching for. It's really almost all on the web anyway, if you really want to watch and look at it.
I didn't realize that it was out there. I actually at one point thought I was going to write to Terrace and ask him if he could send me some of those tapes, but yeah, I would like to see that.
He won't send any, since he sent them to me and heard what I had to say. I don't think he sent them to anybody else.
Okay.
But in any case, yes, I have to unfortunately conclude that Herb Terrace wanted to do in ape language, and that Nim did a lot of things in spite of Herb Terrace that Herb Terrace was very surprised at. He does talk about those quite nicely in his book, and that he began to realize that apes were more competent than he thought, even though language, in his words today, is not one of their competencies.
What did he say they were competent at?
Did Julia say something?
Yeah, I think she did.
I was just curious, like, why does he not want people to think apes have language? Like, is there a reason? I'm just curious.
Well, that's a really good question, and it's the question I ask all the time, because it's not just Herb Terrace that doesn't want people to think, hey, apes have language. It's a lot of other people, some of them very good researchers, and many of them in the zoo world, and many of them in the biomedical world, and many of them in the linguistic world, that don't want apes to have language. I think there's not one simple answer to that question, but I think that the easiest answer I can give to you that's kind of at a level that everybody would understand is, think about what happens in Planet of the Apes. The apes take over and humans become lesser, and some of them humans have no language. And so I think there's a kind of a fear that this myth that is propounded in movies like Planet of the Apes or even Tarzan, if that were real, it would kind of turn the whole world upside down. I mean, that's what the movie Planet of the Apes does. It turns the whole world upside down. So when people begin to think, oh, maybe that isn't just a movie, well, they get uncomfortable. Does that make sense to you?
That's unfortunate, because it sounds interesting, but I think it's fascinating that they do have language.
Well, not only do they have language, and not only is it fascinating, the most fascinating thing of all is that they may be able to do some kinds of things with language that we're not doing. They may organize it in different ways, just like they have these different spatial ways of putting information together. They may put information together, linguistic information, and do things that we might not do with it. And we tend to think of apes as these lesser versions, more brutish versions of ourselves. I realize now that's wrong. They're a different kind of, like, let's say you have a Mac operating system and a PC operating system. They're just different. Apes and humans have these operating systems in their brains, and they're not exactly the same. They're organizing the world in different ways, and they can have very high level capabilities. But let's say they were all talking and doing amazing things. I don't think the conclusion follows that they would be just like us, that they would want all of these material goods around them, that they would want to have wars. I think that's a human way. It's a human pair of glasses that we put on when we think about apes. And we define ourselves as better than indigenous primitive human groups and indigenous primitive human groups as having more culture than apes. But when we talk about that, we're really talking about material culture, objects. When we think about how we interact with each other, how we care about each other, how we understand each other, and all kinds of other culture that have nothing to do with an object, I think apes are certainly equivalent to us and may have surpassed us in some of those aspects. But I think the basic problem is fear. And let's say you're the director of a zoo, Julia, and you have orangs and chimpanzees and bonobos on display, and you make a lot of money from people coming and watching those apes every day. And then you have these other people that say, well, they can talk. If every visitor came and believed that, what would you do with your exhibit?
It would kind of delegitimize their exhibit, because then the apes would be considered on equal, if not superior in some ways, to humans. So I get what you're saying. It's a competitive fear, it seems like. That's interesting.
Yeah, I think that's what it derives from.
Well,
and there may be one other aspect of it. Well, I guess two. People are afraid of interbreeding between humans and apes. And there is the issue of this whole issue of nonverbal behavior, which is very important in moving toward what's now called verbal behavior. But I think it's a kind of intimate language that takes place between the parent and child before the words are actually spoken. It's an intimate, co-constructed dance of caring for one another, or in some cases, obviously not caring for one another. But all the eye gaze, the exchange of affect, whole routines arise between an infant and its caregiver. And for the most part, not that males can't do this, but for the most part, the sensitive caregivers are females. And when you look at the psychological work, only the females engage in these kinds of things that I'm describing, you know, carrying the infants around and spending all day with them and establishing a relationship with them. Male psychologists haven't really wanted to do that. And they've actually said they haven't wanted to do that. And when they've tried to replicate my methods, they've taken their baby chimps home to their wives and had their wives do that. And
just typical.
Yeah, and their wives aren't trained in psychology or linguistics like Aya is. So they don't want to engage in that kind of intimacy. It's one thing to do it with a child that's their child. It's another thing to do it with an ape. Not all males. There are some wonderful males that do not feel this way, but they're very much in the minority. So I think that's another reason that we've had this problem in having these capabilities accepted in the popular mind. And as I mentioned, Terrace isn't the only one who set out to do ape language. And there are many other psychologists. I think without exception, they're all male, who have set out to do ape language in one after the other. But I do think that the general populace is much more like you, much more interested in it, wants to know what's going on, much more flexible, and much more willing to try to understand and be accepting of a species that is really our only living kin. We have, I don't know how many they would say now, at least 30 other individuals that would be called homo that are in our family that have lived, and none of them are alive now. Why would that be?
Because we eradicated their territory, perhaps? Is that the reasons, like with taking over their land? Is that what happened?
Well, they don't really know, but anybody that we don't really like, whether it's an indigenous people or the enemy in the war, like the Japs or whatever, we attach a name to them that's derogatory, and we think of them and we speak of them in terms of animal-like behaviors. We dehumanize them, and it's okay then to kill them.
But you know what, Sue, we don't always kill them. Even the peoples that we defeat in battle, most of the time we kill the leaders and then we take the women and children and they become more like us. So we may have killed them and we may have also mated with them and they may be among us.
That's true, Aya. That's true.
Interesting. I have a lot more to learn from you guys. This is interesting. I'll let you continue. I just was curious about that one question, but very fascinating.
Well, what time are we going to stop tonight?
Well, I think maybe we should stop now. And I said this at the last time, but is it possible to continue? Because there's so much that we haven't talked about. Is it possible? We can't do it next week because we do have another guest scheduled. But how about the week after that? Would you be available?
Yes, that would be fine. Let's see, what date will that be?
So the next week is the 20th, and we have a different guest for that. So I guess it would be the 27th?
The 27th, I think 26th, so.
Yeah, or 26th.
I think so. I might be in Iowa then, but I probably could do it from there.
Yes, it doesn't matter where you are if you have the equipment and the time.
Well, I'll take my computer.
Okay, very good.
This is interesting. I'm so glad to be learning about this new topic. Thank you for sharing with us, Sue.
Well, thank you for listening and asking those great questions. I appreciate it very much.
All right. Well, you have a wonderful night, Sue and Julian.
You too. All right.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye.